Bottom line is, viewers, that for far too long, we have said that there is a foreign hand that benefits from keeping the mayhem alive in India.
Went ahead and described his Indian visit as the trip to end all trips. More in this report.
क्या internationally भारत की image खराब करने के लिए कोई conspiracy हो रही है?
Snapchat CEO Ivan Spiegel had called India a poor country and allegedly said that his company has no intentions of expanding its base in poor countries such as India, as the app is only for rich people.
क्या होगा कि विदेशी ताकतें अक्सर भारत की छवि खराब करने की कोशिश करती हैं। विदेशी मीडिया हो या फिर विदेशी कंपनी, हमेशा ब्रांड इंडिया को कमतर करके ही आंका जाता है।
Welcome to Argumentative Indians, a platform for honest debates. My name is Yajur Arora and I will be moderating today's debate. We have a very interesting lineup of panelists today from very different facets of life. We have politics, education, literature, entertainment, and technology. So it's a very interesting and very diverse set of perspectives, which is great because the objective of this debate is not to pick a winning side or to settle any issue, but it is to examine the topic from multiple dimensions in order to become better informed. So over the last few years, we've seen several incidents when a critical comment by a Western personality or even just an article or a tweet can create a storm in India. And going by the reactions we see on social media or various news outlets. So my opening question is our 5,000-year-old civilization so fragile that it's shaking by the mere comment of a foreign pop star or a teenager? And to kickstart, I invite the panelists to introduce themselves and lay out their case. Okay, perfect. Let's start with you. In the meantime, we'll figure out with Shweta what's going on.
Okay, we have 1 minute, right, Yajur?
Yes, please.
Okay. But frankly, India as a democracy today is extremely vulnerable. Our institutions of governance seems to have completely gone into a rigor mortis, whether it's a free mainstream media, law enforcement, the other, you know, the police authorities, you know, look at income tax, enforcement directorate, CBI. Frankly, every instrument of governance has now become a tool for political vendetta. Journalists, intellectuals, Disha Ravi, a climate activist, has, you know, the police flying in from Delhi to arrest her. And you know, you have had the Supreme Court judges who not a couple of years ago actually went public. Four Supreme Court judges went public and said India's democracy is in danger. So, you know, this is coming from the horse's mouth. Never happened before. Why did it happen just a couple of years ago? Let's be honest, there are many journalists who have lost their jobs. Many are being told to toe the line. And I guess this is the new political model for many democracies. We believe that just because there is an election, the country is free. That is not true. Leaders win an election and then they throttle democracy. Examples before you are Mr. Putin, Mr. Erdogan, Donald Trump, who had scant respect for the media and for governance and institutions. And in India today, you face a major crisis. And the crisis is that if you speak today and you're critical of the government, you're called an anti-national, you're told to go to Pakistan, you may be threatened with a defamation suit on an FIR. Basically, you're being told, practice self-censorship. If you're critical of the BJP or the government of Mr. Modi, God help you.
Thank you, Sanjay. Let's move on to Vikram. Nobody's going to make any objections while you're laying out the case. So we'll just move on to Vikram. Everyone will make out the case first, and then we'll get into a conversation.
Sure. Good evening, everyone. I'm Vikram Sampath, author and historian based in Bangalore. Yajur, to your proposition of this debate, which I think was more about Western criticism of India, the external criticism of India, rather than the internal situation within the country. I partially agree with the proposition to the extent that, you know, we've still probably not decolonized our minds after 75 years of independence, where we seek constant validation, especially from our past colonial masters and the color of the skin of the person who's commenting about us, particularly if that comment comes in media, maybe in the UK, in the US, and so on, where we feel as a country a need to respond to that. But that does not mean that there is no bias that exists against India. It's not something new. It didn't start now. Right from the time India became independent, I think for the longest time, we've been written off as a country. Even when India got her independence, and I'm not trying to sound alarmist or like a conspiracy theorist here, but then right since then, the doomsday predictors always said that we are not going to last as a nation. We have too many diversities. We have too many multi, you know, everything is multi about this nation that we can't stick together. But then 7 decades later, and despite a very tumultuous neighborhood, which has not, which has almost dismembered, we as a nation have stayed on. And we've done pretty well on many counts. We've at least stayed together as a country. And so there are lobbies and groups across the world who are certainly not happy about this. And this bias would manifest itself in numerous ways. So there are geopolitical responses that would come, or I mean, in your proposition itself, you list a long set of names from Wendy Doniger to Justin Trudeau to Greta Thunberg to Rihanna. I think each of it is a very unique and a different kind of an example. And each of that would require different responses from the Indian state and also as Indians. So that bias that I talked about manifests itself either in geopolitical responses or more insidiously in cultural and civilizational narratives. Because for you know, historically, the European imagination of India has always been a place that has existed outside of history. Like German philosopher Hegel wrote that India with her unique psychology, religion, caste system, holy men, always existed in a dreamlike state. But then like any other place in the world, India was not and has not and does not exist in a dreamlike state. She has her own very complex economic, social, cultural, political issues, which irrespective of whether the West or the rest of the world understands or takes note of, these exist. So as also an academic, I would look at this problem from themes of social constructivism as to how a group of people look at us from the outside and make assumptions, or through a post-colonial theory of, oriental outlook to India, of looking at us as the other, a tourist gaze, or worse, as archetypes, stereotypes, deep-rooted archetypes and stereotypes that are made of us from the time we were called, snake charmers and elephant riders and all of that, to whatever we have today. So to a large extent, I would go against the motion, but partially I agree to the extent that we seek that validation even now. We don't have that self-confidence of not wanting external validation.
Thanks, Vikram. We'll move on to Shweta now.
Thanks for having me, Yajur. I have a bad throat, so pardon my voice if you can't hear me very loud. I'll try and be as loud as I can. Good afternoon.
Don't worry. Go ahead.
Yes. Good afternoon to everyone watching and to all the panelists. I will be speaking for the motion. I do believe that in India, we are extraordinarily hypersensitive towards external criticism. And, we as Indians have reacted very badly to criticism of any nature, external, internal. We have shown a lack of rigor and fairness when it comes to criticism. We either call it unfair, we call it undue in worst case scenarios, we even call it a conspiracy to defame India. Let me go so far as saying we are intolerant to criticism. We are a patriotic lot. And so a cartoon on FB to a post that is offensive on social media, everything offends us. We have often mobilized nationalistic sentiment. We have evoked territorial sovereignty to fend off criticism. The fact that I called all of us intolerant, I know will not go down well with many, but I'll try and substantiate that through the course of this debate through hard facts. Now we have fallen many places on various indexes on democracy, in freedom, in access to internet, but we continue to live in denial. We have in all these cases denied the reports, we have brushed aside the data, we've called it India's internal matter. So we have asked the countries, the respective countries which have come up with these data sets to look within them, to introspect on their own track record before they preach India what to do, what not to do. And unless, of course, the entire world is conspiring against us, unless, of course, all of us or everybody has come together outside of India to conspire against India, there is a problem. And we are missing that problem. And that's not going to go down very well for the development of the country. We need to acknowledge if there is a problem. Let's remember criticism is for the greater good at times. And until we acknowledge there is a problem, we cannot really find a solution. We cannot continue to remain stubborn, high-headed, and dismissive of everything that is not spoken in favor of us.
And just to clarify, Shweta, you are not talking of linking this to any specific government. You're talking generally that this is idiosyncratic about Indian population or culture or something of the sort. Okay, thank you. And then we'll move on again to the opposite side with Shashank. Shashank, let's get your view. You're based for more than a decade in Europe. So you are sitting there in the West. It's good to get your perspective as well.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Thanks, Yaju. So my background is basically artificial intelligence. So I don't know how much of political science should I be talking about. So please bear with me if I'm wrong. I'm very humble to accept that one. But when I see it from a very, very logical point of view, I am not certain whether there is any truth in this statement, mainly because this is a very extreme statement. Extreme statements requires extreme proof. It doesn't require just normal proof, right? And this proof can come from either the causal link or the statistics, you know, and nowhere I find enough proof to say that India is hypersensitive. For example, is it hypersensitive more than China or some other country or whatever? I don't find even the causal link. Why should India be hypersensitive? I mean, hypersensitivity in psychology comes from low self-esteem. Our generation is actually gaining self-esteem in India. So it doesn't make a lot of sense to me that India is actually becoming hypersensitive now, right? Then there is also a question of irony, where, for example, Greta, or doesn't matter who it is, they are free to actually criticize India, but somehow it is bad to criticize them back. I don't see it as a fair play. And so everyone is basically free to criticize and should actually be able to put up their views, right? So we are being a little bit ironical here, I would say, because there's nothing harm in criticizing these people who are criticizing the country. Yeah? So it is fair, in my opinion, basically. This would be my statement, Yajur.
Regarding so your point is India is not hypersensitive. Its reactions are fairly natural and normal. Moving on to Sukrit, let's get back. Let's last person on the panel to get his case.
Hi. Thank you for having me, Ajur. I sort of there's partially some truth, of course, in a lot of what everyone has said, and a part of me does agree with the bits of what everyone has said. My larger concern is with this idea of nationalism and nationalistic pride. With this whole us versus them sort of approach that we've been seeing over the years. This is not an India problem, by the way. We are seeing this in populations and countries across the world where governments are being or elected based on more nationalistic fervor on a very us versus them mandate. And that pride, when does pride turn out to be toxic? When does it get from love and appreciation to a place of hatred and fear is what we need to sort of look back as an entire civilization and sort of understand that. So that's probably why I say that, yes, we are a little hypersensitive, but it's not only an India problem. We are seeing this as a pattern emerge across various countries in the world. Today, I don't need to remind you of places like the US where the storming of the Capitol happened recently. I mean, these kind of activities are happening because there is a narrative that is being driven that I am better than the other, right? As far as an international conspiracy against India is concerned, yes, there have been biases in the past against India. There have been biases that the West has held overall against the East. There has always been a fear of a rise of the East in the mind of the West. And whenever power comes into play, obviously fear starts, playing up. So yes, there is, there has been a bias. Is there an international collective conspiracy against India? I don't know if that would be factually correct to say.
Thank you, Sukrit. So it's actually interesting because Shashank, just before you, he says it's pretty normal the way we react. We are not hypersensitive. You think we are hypersensitive, but so is everyone. So I have a question based on both these statements. If a celebrity in, let's say, Germany, where you are sitting, Sushant, if a celebrity over there were to make a very negative, if a celebrity in India, let's say some film star, Bollywood film star, makes a negative comment about Germany, do you think that all the German channels, the national TV would talk about it? That will become the headlines, the newspapers, there would be a Twitter storm. How does Kangana Ranaut say this about Germany? Do you see that ever happening?
This wouldn't happen for sure, but not for the reason that we are saying so. So this wouldn't happen because the world is not a symmetric place. So the influence of Germany on India, the ecosystem, the economy or the politics is much more than in the reverse direction, right? The same happens, for example, with India and Bangladesh. So, or India and some countries in Africa, for example. So the world is not symmetric. So obviously we would react more to the Western, celebrities, simply because we are more exposed to them, right? Than in German media, you hardly hear about Kangana Ranaut, for example. Right. So this is not because we are oversensitive. It's only because we are exposed more, basically, to such celebrities, and then we react. Calling us, branding us as oversensitive when we react to this is basically the ironical thing that I said. So it should be basically on both the directions. Yeah.
We had never heard of Rihanna before, as in most of India had not heard of Rihanna until she made a comment. And it was, I think that's become her claim to fame. I'd like to get Sanjay on this one.
Well, Yajur, frankly, who had even heard of Greta Thunberg other than, you know, the urban intellectuals of India? Not many people had even heard of her. I think at the end of the day, tomorrow, Miley Cyrus or, you know, Justin Bieber says something and then India's foreign minister will issue a statement. Nothing can be more absurd or preposterous. Mm-hmm. And to believe that this great Indian democracy, yes, it has gone through turbulent times. Nobody's going to deny that. No democracy is perfect. We have had aberrations like the emergency. We continue to have an environment of an unofficial emergency in India. But the fact of the matter is, well, there is some fight back happening. The worry that you have at the moment is that when an international respected think tank calls India partly free, or another says that we are an elected autocracy, everything is dismissed as a left-wing, you know, some kind of a liberal conspiracy against India. I mean, I have never seen India appear so defensive, almost in trepidation at some foreign criticism. We all know what happened to Atish Taseer because he wrote an article in the Times of India, in the Times magazine, where he called Mr. Modi the great divider. I mean, but this is the way a democracy is meant to function. Sashank mentioned that, you know, it won't happen in Germany. Frankly speaking, I mean, people outside are beginning to see us as a laughing stock. I mean, Rihanna makes a statement, you know, it is a done thing. International celebrities, you know, support causes. I mean, it is nothing unusual, but calling a toolkit as an attempt to destabilize India, a 22-year-old golden girl in Bangalore could bring the 303 members Lok Sabha of the BJP down to ruins. I mean, how ridiculous is this? So the fact of the matter, Yajur, is very straightforward. And let's bite the bullet. Let's not pretend. External criticism is what we are addressing. But why are we addressing that? Because there is no internal democracy the way it should be in our country. Ask any journalist in India, are they free to say what they have to? How many corporates in India will stand up and say that they are unhappy with the state of the economy or the budget? How many people in India today have the guts to go and question many things that the government does on Twitter or Facebook and not face an assault on social media? Come on, let's be honest. I mean, the fact is, you know, this is not an issue on which we need to, you know, frankly, pussyfoot around. India today is not the democracy it is meant to be. Those who believe it is great, Vikram mentioned about, you know, the international perception that India will get dismembered. Well, that's historical. I think that debate is long over. Everybody knows that India's soft power abroad was our democratic credentials. Today, the reason why India is not a failed state like Pakistan, or look at India's neighbors, Maldives, Pakistan, Nepal, Myanmar, Bangladesh, they've had bloody coups. They've gone through illiberal phases. But why is India suddenly getting inspired by the wrong models? I mean, just because we have an election, let us not fool ourselves that we are a democracy. Today, people are paranoid. Mr. Shashank should come to India. And when you do, whether it is a superficial or artificial intelligence, good luck to you. But if you were to take on this government, my friend, there could be people asking you tough questions. And today, people in business worry about enforcement directorate, income tax, whatnot. Why is Aamir Khan gone off social media today? Let's ask ourselves that question. You know, celebrities need social media to promote their films. Why is Aamir Khan gone off social media? Why does Shah Rukh Khan not address issues? And by the way, linked to this entire debate is the attack on minorities. Please don't ignore it. Please don't ignore it. It is linked to the way in India, in a majoritarian nationalism environment that Sukrit mentioned about, minorities are targeted, whether you're an Adivasi, whether you're a Dalit, whether you are a, you know, Muslim or a Christian. There are fundamental issues in our country. Okay. And when Twitter is being told you, please kindly change your policy. When you have Facebook, which was openly batting for the government, when internet shutdowns in Kashmir are an issue, you can't ignore it. And by the way, in an interconnected world, when India goes abroad and asks for foreign direct investment and says, yay, this is the amount of $70 billion we got, the highest in our history. But you are very, very paranoid when people question you on human rights. Human rights, by the way, is never the you know, just your domain, shall we say, responsibility. We question other countries when they violate issues. Don't Indian commentators comment on Uyghur Muslims being brutalized in China? And as somebody rightly mentioned in the beginning, you compared it with China, but China is the wrong comparison, man.
No, that's absolutely right. That's what I was going to point out, that China is not the comparison we want to look up to. But at the same time, I think I agree with a lot of what you said, Sanjay, but there is more than the government objecting to criticism. We also see people objecting to criticism. So for example, having lived myself for 10 years in the US, I know that within India, we can criticize on the Kashmir matters or whatever. But when we see foreigners criticize, then the whole Indian expat community goes up in arms. We don't want Americans to criticize us for, like, it's our internal issue. We don't want them to be commenting on. But that's very normal in the United States for pop stars, film stars, everybody to comment on all the issues, not just about India, but Russia. They talk about China. They talk about Europe, France, everything. But when it's about India, it sort of like draws a line for Indian Americans and normal people get very angry. And on base of this, so I want to ask, a bias. Do we all agree on this panel that there is a bias in the Western media against India? And you can raise your hand if you don't think there is. And if you all agree there is, then should we ignore these things, or is it the right approach?
Can I just add something to what was already said? I really do not subscribe to this, you know, alarmist theory that, and I'm honestly, I'm no spokesperson of the government or have any affinity with it. But then this whole browbeating and alarmist theory about everything in this country is so wrong. We're just sitting on in an undeclared emergency. I find that a little, too far from truth. Forget the government. Sanjay here is somebody, is the opposition also a part of the problem then, Sanjay? Because forget criticizing the government or its head. In your party, you could not even criticize your own leader, and for which you're a living victim. And you have the G23 within your own group, which is not able to talk out against its leadership. So what do we talk about? Free speech and expression of thought. Now, this whole Rihanna issue or whatever, I don't think it is that innocent that, you know, some celebrity, in just a very, the same period of time, lots and lots of people tweeting about Indian agriculture, of which they know nothing about. Greta Thunberg should be the first person who should not be supporting the farming theories in Punjab, which goes completely against everything that she perhaps stands for, whether it's stubble burning or water intensive crops, whether it is, the kind of the monoculture of soil that is there because of paddy and wheat and all of that. So almost around the same time, from John Cusack to Mina Harris to Greta to Rihanna to everyone doing it, and also the links to all these organizations. We can close our eyes and say Sikhs for Justice, the World Sikh Organization, the Poetic Justice Foundation, who not historically wanting to dismember India, but as late as 2020, the World Sikh Organization in their London referendum said the main aim of our organization is to liberate Punjab from Indian occupation. So all these celebrities who were tweeting, and now what happened to all their concern about the so-called farmer genocide that was happening in India? Was that what was going, where farmers were being killed on streets? That's like an overstatement. That is the hypersensitivity there. And I don't know how, whether, I'm not saying whether it was right for the Minister of External Affairs to come out and talk about it. That's left to the government to decide how important or what was the strategic need for that, because it was more than what meets the eye. That it was not a mere coincidence, just as all the celebrities in India, from Lata Mangeshkar to Sachin Tendulkar to everybody who tweeted later, that was also orchestrated. Similarly, the campaign before that was also orchestrated, and most of these celebrities don't tweet for free. So obviously there was a lot of money that was being paid to somebody to tweet about a cause that they don't understand about, through dubious organizations which have ramifications for our national security. And in which case the government stepping in and talking about it, I don't think that is such a big cause for a collapse of freedom of expression. Routinely you have people like, say, some Shahid Afridi and all these characters who go around talking all kinds of nonsense about India, about Kashmir. We haven't seen the Ministry of External Affairs coming and putting out statements on that. So somewhere here, where it is not so innocent and so spontaneous an outrage that came out from people who were so deeply pained by the, Indian agriculture situation or the farmers issue. So that was what I think led to
conspiracy. You're alluding to a potential foreign conspiracy, which is a bit more extreme than just a general bias.
We are having a bigger conspiracy being alluded to, Yajur, where we are saying everything in India has collapsed. We don't even have a democracy. We are just a sham. So this is a bigger conspiracy that we are talking about.
I just wanted to add to that. I think, Shweta, you go ahead.
I'll come to you in a minute. I'll come to you. Before that, I want to extend these questions to the audience as well. So I'm going to launch a poll where we are going to ask the audience, first of all, is there a Western bias against India? Secondly, does India overreact to foreign criticism and commentary? And third, should India just ignore it? Would that be more dignified for us as a nation, the largest democracy in the world? So I will open this to this poll, and people can respond to this at their own convenience, but let's continue. So Shweta, you were saying something. I'll bring you in first.
Yes, Sanjay mentioned that you should talk to a journalist when you want to assess where we stand as a democracy. I'm glad he also talked about the track record of the Congress party, the party that he's been associated with. It's important that I'm bringing this up, and I'll move from this very quickly. It's also important to know that as far as the track record of the Congress party is concerned with respect to democracy, freedom, it does not stand very well. So I'm going to be a journalist here who's not limited in her approach and is not only looking at the track record of one party, but trying to analyze from a broader perspective, saying so.
You can continue this, but let's not make this about Congress versus BJP. Right. We're not going to. It's about as a society, as a people. How do we tend to? But I'll let you finish this thing. But let's just not go too much into the
Absolutely.
Congress.
No, absolutely. So as I said, I'm going to be moving on from this very quickly. So I do not agree, with Mr. Jha when he says that, we are doomed and there is a sham of a democracy. So I agree with Sampath that there is some sort of, red flag that we show every time when we talk about freedom in this country. And so it may not be, it's not as bad as it seems. It's not as bad as the Western media portrays it to be. So to the larger question, whether there is a bias in the Western media, something that Shashank mentioned, that everybody in this country knows Rihanna. Not really. Just the day after she tweeted, my mother happened to ask me, who's Rihanna? And here's a woman who's never really gone on internet, don't really know about who a pop singer is. So obviously, as Sampath pointed out, there has to be some sort of a pushback from someone for Rihanna to come up and tweet. But if you look at that tweet, and if you try to analyze that tweet, in that tweet, she simply says, let's talk about it, hashtag farmers protest. So she did not put out her opinion on what farmers protest is. She did not, actually delve into any details on whether she supports the farmers movement in India. All she was trying to say is, let's talk about that. And in the process of trying to pull her down, we ended up, pulling her pictures back from 2008 and 9, we were abusing her. She was being trolled in this country. So the reaction that we gave to that tweet was, in fact, I think that goes on to show that somewhere or the other, we are in fact hypersensitive.
I would just add one more thing, Shweta. So having lived in the US for 10 years, I can tell you one thing. In the US, there is a lot of discussion about how their media is biased. And a lot of times you see that their media usually is criticizing or talking about protests in Paris, London, Tokyo, but they would never talk about a massive protest going on in somewhere in India or Lebanon or whatever. And that is usually what they're accused of. And now suddenly when they say that, let's talk about this thing, no media is covering this massive protest going on in India. Why not talk about it? Now suddenly we are again accusing the celebrities. Okay, why are you biased? Why are you bringing up India? Usually in the US, they're criticized for not bringing up developing countries or non-white countries.
I just wanted to, Shashank, chime in for a second. Two things. One, I do agree to a large extent with what Vikram and Shweta have said in terms of raising the flags and having this alarmist approach of, we are dying as a country or as a democracy. It's not that bad yet. Yes, there are certain red flags, definitely. I don't want to get into all of those. But extending what Shashank had said about statistics and taking forward what Shweta had said about this Rihanna issue, if you look at the internet searches, right, on Google, the highest ever in the history, ever historically, were of these two terms, Rihanna Muslim and Rihanna religion. Right. Now, my question is, my point of view is this, right? We need to be extremely harsh with our politicians, and we need to understand that politicians are here not to serve only the public, they are there to serve themselves and their party. Right. They are not here only to only do what is good for the country because they have a larger agenda at play. And let's all be fair about it. That's what it is. Right. Those days are gone where, we can expect such kind of a moral value system from them, sadly. But those days are gone. That's one. So to expect our politicians to be completely whitewashed and completely good and completely fair is wrong. Second, when a celebrity tweets something, right? Understand that, yes, like Shweta said, did she give her opinion about it? No, she did not. She merely shone a light on something that is happening in a particular country. Then it's up to you as the viewer to understand or get into it and see what you want to say, right? The fact that is alarming for me is that Google searches like, is Rihanna Muslim? What is Rihanna's religion? Is what is suddenly peaking on Google when she's speaking about something which has probably not much to do with the larger issue at hand. And that is the insecurity that we are feeding in our nation. That is the fear that we are feeding to the people. That is the level of divisiveness that we have gotten to. Not having constructive conversations, but feeding or sort of going to the baser emotions of human beings and dividing them on those, right? And that is where the real problem lies. All of this is hoo-ha. It's all external. Our people talking, not talking, media, politicians, brands, celebrities. The fact of the matter is that millions of people around the world today are being created or are being put into this echo chamber of fear. That is where the problem lies, and that is where the larger problem is.
It's a good point. The problem is we are thinking everybody has an agenda. We just can't imagine somebody wants to highlight the case of these people who are protesting for good reasons or bad reasons, but they are normal citizens. They have a right to protest. And the fact that that's not getting enough attention, when somebody calls out for attention, but having said it, all of a sudden, we think, what is the agenda? Is this a communal agenda? Is this a conspiracy? But Vikram had earlier point said that Rihanna or Greta, they don't really know anything. They don't understand these issues around farmers and stuff. So it's a bit strange them coming out all of a sudden out of the blues on talking. Fair point. But it's not just these two isolated cases. Even when we look at the case of Wendy Doniger, when she is one of the world's renowned scholars in Sanskrit and Hindu theology.
Not at all. She knows not a word of Sanskrit.
Sorry, Vikram, I'm going to give you. But she is recognized globally as a renowned scholar of Sanskrit texts. And still, when she says something, which she clearly says, it's her own view, it's her own understanding, it's her own take on it, we go crazy. We try to get the books banned. The Penguin publisher had to pull out the books out of India. it creates a very embarrassing situation. We don't create a very great image globally when we try, when we say we are the largest democracy in the world, and we are so shaken by one woman writing her own views on our religion. Suddenly our 5,000 year old religion is all insecure. Vikram, please go ahead.
I completely disagree with you, Yajur, on this, because it comes closer to my discipline, which is academia and history and so on, where, as I said right in the beginning, one is all these geopolitics, which we can talk about, but the more insidious thing is the cultural narratives, the civilizational narratives that are more dangerous, perhaps, and more long-lasting. For the longest period of time, we've outsourced any study of our own culture, our faiths, our history to outsiders. So it's so easy for us, and there again, our lack of self-worth, our lack of self-confidence as a country comes across so strongly that we are so beholden by the fact that someone with a fair skin can come and tell us about our own past, our own religions, and we give that person extraordinary space and importance. The reverse would not be true. I will not be able to go to the UK and write a book on the Tudor dynasty and become an expert on it and also become an arbiter of literary merits in the UK. But the reverse can happen, and we know whom we're talking about. But time and again in academia, particularly in the West, scholarly tomes have been written, and Wendy Doniger is just one example. There are numerous others, scholarly tomes on Hinduism, which are so biased, which make it sound almost like a bizarre and grotesque mix of voodoo and pornography, where most of these people do not understand a word of Sanskrit. Wendy is not a scholar of Sanskrit. She herself has said she doesn't understand any Sanskrit. So we can very well have a Wendy or an Audrey Trush who can come on so condescendingly without even understanding a word of Sanskrit or Persian or Tamil or any Indian language, and we are the victim colonized country. You come and tell us that, Aurangzeb was a great guy, you better accept it. And we are supposed to accept it because we were your slaves at some point. So these tomes on Hinduism, which are represented in Wendy's book, for instance, since you brought her up, she likens Ganesha's trunk to represent a flaccid phallus, and his love for sweets is an inclination towards oral sex, right? And one of her own disciples, students said Ramakrishna Paramahamsa and Vivekananda, both of them, the former was a pedophile who had homoerotic desires, which led him to sexually abuse his disciples, particularly Vivekananda. So these are the professors who teach South Asian history, comparative religions across the best universities of the West, particularly in America. Their books and research are found in the best of libraries. Huge grants for research are given by committees over which they preside. And this narrative of India, the same Oriental colonial narrative of the land of the pagans, the dark country which needs reforms, this is perpetuated in a very sophisticated way by academicians across. Now, what is the response? Are we supposed to say, oh, that's freedom of speech, freedom of expression, you can write what you want? In all fairness, I do not agree with the that her book needed to be banned or whatever. It was not banned. It was withdrawn by the publisher. There was not a fig leaf of violence that happened on that issue, unlike what happened with Salman Rushdie's book was banned by Rajiv Gandhi's India, even before Ayatollah Khomeini's Iran banned it. In this case, Dinanath Batra, whom I totally disagree his views, went to the court, used legal recourse. You have those statute, those laws in your statute, say it offends your religious sentiments. On basis of that, the case was filed. So even if you take recourse to the law in a peaceful manner and get your point of view across, even that is considered as a wrong thing. So what is a person supposed to do? You cannot match the intellectual heft. You cannot match the wealth and the academic wealth that people like Wendy have internationally, to have so many books written. It can be done, but it'll take a long time. So the least they could do was go and get it withdrawn, and the publishers did it. So how is that so bad?
They got it withdrawn only in India, but still Wendy continues to preach that to the whole world. But your point taken, right? That there are people of influence who have biases, inherent biases against India. And if we do not object, if we do not object so vehemently, they will propagate those biases even more across the whole Western world. Fair point. And there's a question from the audience, which is sort of on the same lines. They're saying, see, they continue to emphasize India's issues and ignore India's successes and bring down India. Isn't there foreign isn't there bias in the foreign media, blah, blah, blah. And before we continue, I think there are a lot of people here who are suggesting there is a bias in the foreign, but I think a more interesting question is, why would there be a bias against India? We are not China. We are not at odds with them in terms of, we also believe in democracy, freedom of speech, pretty much the same values as Western countries do. We don't have an alternate ideology like Russia or China. What might then be the reason? If anything, we are helping the West by being a massive country of 1.3 billion people, also endorsing the Western values. So why would they have a bias against India? What is their bone against India? And I don't know whoever wants to start.
Jeju, can I come in?
Can I come in here, if you don't mind?
After that, you're next. Yes, please, Sanjay.
Okay. My short point, I think I need to kind of be forthright here. It is a ridiculous proposition that the Western world or the Western media has a bias against India. Media is both right-wing, media is also liberal. Yes, the New York Times and the CNN and the Washington Post are more pro-liberal. They're more pro-Democrats. We all know where Fox News comes in. We all know where Republic comes in. It's a pretty balanced game. To say that the country is biased is ridiculous. And I'll tell you why. I've been a banker, so I can make this one statement here. Foreign multinational companies, whether they're British, American, they need the Indian labor market and Indian consumer markets. So frankly speaking, they're trying to woo India. So to believe that the media is allowed to go after Indian political establishment is quite ridiculous. In fact, I believe the Indian political establishment leverages its commercial clout to therefore tell Facebook or Twitter, kindly change your stance, because they know that India is the biggest social media market today for some of these big giants. So, I mean, I think that whole proposition is bizarre and I don't want to even discuss it. But all my panelists actually, in my opinion, I disagree with Shweta, Vikram, Supreet, and Shashank, because they have all fallen actually into the trap of saying Indian democracy is not that bad. But that's exactly what we are talking about. You all conceded here on this platform, which is being recorded and which will be shown on the internet, that you are compromised. You know, today Shweta has reached a point that she's very happy that she's not arrested for perhaps criticizing the government. Hey, there is democracy. Yaar, utna bura to nahi hai. So somebody else will come and say, you know what, I haven't got an FIR today because they today attacked maybe the chief minister of a BJP ruled state. You see, the new normal in India, Yajur, is that the standards are so low that they have all publicly confessed ki utna bura nahi hai. Now, I believe that either a democracy is vibrant, there is free speech, there is no fear, things are running well, or it is fairly badly screwed up. And, you know, you can say it's a hybrid. You know, everybody here says it's a hybrid. As long as you see everybody here on this panel is pretty much, you know, I would say we are all privileged. We are all the urban elite. So yaha par nobody has an issue, but this is not what we are talking about. Please go and ask Munawar Faruqi, who spent weeks in jail for a joke he never cracked. Please go into the people who are being charged today with sedition. There is Mr. Sampath. You criticize the colonial Western bias, but the governments of the day, including the Congress and the current BJP, are hanging on to a colonial section 124A to terrorize its own people on the pretext that India is facing a threat to its national security. I mean, these are manifestations of a vulnerable state. And my last point, Yajur, my last point before, because I need to go in another few minutes. You know, when you talk of self-confidence, where did the self-confidence tell us that you can today lynch your own people? The self-confidence is not that I've become a majoritarian community and I'll today tell anybody in my country, how dare you criticize India? Our prestige, our reputation is at stake. I mean, that is not called self-confidence. You know what a true self-confidence is, Vikram? When you tell people, come and take me on, tell me what are my fault lines and I will answer you back. But I will not go and threaten you. I will not go and insinuate that you are paid. Rihanna was never paid. That was insinuated. And by the way, the celebrities who tweeted in support of the farmers, were they paid as well? And which government ever should call its protesting farmers anti-national or Khalistanis? There may be one or two rotten apples, but to bracket your own protesting farmers as Khalistanis, as secessionists, I rest my case.
So, Yajur, can I come in?
I'd like to just quickly respond if I may.
No. Shashank, you want to keep speaking for very long?
No, Shweta, we'll come to you.
I know you have to answer something. Shweta, something. We'll come to you next. But Shashank has been wanting to say something for very long, and I want to bring
yes, before I forget,
in case that India is actually becoming more confident, that is why these things are happening. So it's a very polar opposite case. I want Shashank to speak.
Yeah. So basically, what I said initially was the causal and the statistical link. And the causal link is what we should be asking: why are we becoming like this? Not just that we are claiming that we are becoming like this. Why exactly, right? And like Sanjay is saying that there is everything is burning down or whatever. I don't believe in this simply because there is no causal link to it. What is happening, in my opinion, is basically there are more channels now to express those opinions. We have been going through right from the day when the page rank was invented with a Google, right? So and now we actually care about the likes of the people visiting our web page, blogs, whatever. There is an interaction going both ways. Basically, there are lots and lots of people who are now into the dialogue, and it's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. So if Greta has been, let's say, people are opposing Greta, it's a good thing, because many of them will not be abusing her, but will be actually taking down the points why she's wrong. The same goes with Wendy. By banning Wendy, actually, we did a great favor to her. Like Vikram said, I have never seen in my life something so preposterous like Wendy has written in her book. And if it was actually going through some rigorous peer review, it wouldn't be ever published, trust me. So we have done a great favor to people like that by banning them, for example, but not to ourselves. What we should be doing.
We not banned, Vikram corrected us. There was no banning, but the publisher, because of the outrage in India.
Yeah, but this is the point that we actually did a favor by doing this. Instead, what we should have done is we should have taken that book and we should have analyzed more and more, just like what Sanjay was saying. I completely agree with Sanjay on that one, that we should be actually discussing more. And in that regard,
destroying her theories one by one.
Exactly. And this is why I think sometimes we are not sensitive enough. If we were really sensitive about our culture, about the way it is represented, you actually take the book and you actually counter every point of it.
Yeah? Shashank, thank you. I have to move to Shweta, but I will just make one point. When you say her book was not peer reviewed, I just want to, just looking it up online, she got several awards for that book from various, I don't have the ability to tell how great these organizations are, but even Indian critics in Hindustan Times, they had appreciated her book. The book, The Hindus, which...
Very biased views, I would say. But yeah. Enough.
Everyone agrees on the bias. Okay, Shweta, your turn. We move on
yes,
to...
Yes. You know, just to quickly answer first, I think it'd be unfair to say that we are all compromised if we do not quite agree with the fact that, you know, one party is better than the other. I understand Mr. Jha has certain inclinations to a certain party. I don't. As a journalist, it's my responsibility to be fair and accurate when I judge the track records of the party that's ruled the country for good 70 years versus a party that's come to power for the last two consecutive elections. Now, coming to the more important part on whether in this country today, we should be happy that we're not arrested for speaking up. Any government for that matter, and I don't think any government should be dealt with a light rope in this case, because every government for that matter had clamped down on criticism in the past. So it's not specific to the ruling government, ruling dispensation today. Every government has problem with those who are dissenting. The dissenters have already, we have always, in fact, brushed the ruling dispensation wrongly. And so is the case today. But coming to Greta, because we're talking about Greta Thunberg and we're talking about Rihanna time and again, I do quite agree with Sukrit when he says that the kind of reaction that we saw on the internet in India, the kind of searches we saw, one of the news anchors went on to call Rehana, trying to so as to indicate an Islamophobic slur that she is not Rehana, she is Rehana. So and there were searches and her photographs were pulled out and people were trying to understand whether she's a Muslim and that's the reason why she's supporting farmers' protest in India. They may not know what farmers' protest is. They do not know and may not know what deregulation the the farm market deregulation, how that's going to help farmers in India, but they have all the right to talk about it. If we go on and talk about Black Lives Matter every day when it's happening in India, they have all the right to talk about what's happening in India, and they have the platform and they have the following, and if they want their followers to talk about it too, I don't see a problem with that. No, and at no point did I see a celebrity, at least a foreign celebrity, saying that you should support farmers' law, farm laws in India, or you should be opposing the government on farm laws. All they said is that, look, farmers are protesting, they're out on streets, they've been out on streets for more than 6 months, and therefore you should talk about it. Because remember, when Rihanna tweeted, this was just after the violence, or the 26th January violence, and the internet had been cut off in various protesting sites, and she actually linked that in her tweet, and she said, look, they're not getting access to internet and we should be talking about it. And I see no harm in that, but to insinuate that she was paid, and it's just a conspiracy theory that many people have tried to propagate, but there's absolutely no harm to that.
Just one statement is, why being so touchy about being paid? Somebody has an opinion that she was paid, and why should be she so harmed?
Truth matters at the end of the day. If you have absolutely no factual proof of that, if you
Wendy doesn't care for truth,
let's not at least try and
why different scale?
But Shashank, she made her point of view, and we made a point of view that it's she might be paid. This is a bit strange. She doesn't know anything about India. It's fine. There is no reason that people can't criticize somebody else for commenting. I think that's totally fine. But Vikram, you made a point about like some organizations getting involved in it, like the ones who support Punjab independence and all. It's, first of all, they have a view that Punjab should be independent, and they're working towards it. In wherever they are based, they're allowed to hold those views. Maybe they're not in India. But the fact that they support anybody critical of India doesn't necessarily mean that anybody criticizes only India if they're paid by these organizations. There's no causality there necessarily.
Can you say that again? I mean,
sorry. So,
okay.
Go on, sorry.
Whatever, the way it was dealt with, again, as I said,
it's fishy. I take it.
Not an advocate of what things, how things went on, whether that whole discussion in that, there's Mo Dhaliwal, who was a part of that poetic justice of poet. Whatever, say Justice Foundation or whatever, and these people having entered, because farmers of India are not just farmers from Punjab and Haryana, right? I mean, farmers are there all over India. So why should this issue just gets concentrated to one state and one particular region? So and that gets so much of international importance, and there is a significant constituency of the same Punjabis and Sikhs and so on in Canada, in UK, which is where this gets amplified. And that's the only reason why I'm saying this is not so innocent. We just need to see the strategic and the geopolitical story behind all of this, that this was not something. So tomorrow, if there is, so you had the suppose there's a protest in Andhra Pradesh or somewhere, unless it matters to someone, a constituency abroad, I don't think anyone is going to amplify it. Protests can happen all over the place, anywhere in this country, which is so huge. You had this lady Irom Sharmila in Manipur, who went on a hunger strike for 18 years. Did it matter to somebody in Canada or US? It didn't, because she was not a constituency. If Manipur was on someone's priority, they would have spoken about it. So that's what I'm saying. This is not so innocent, human rights and bleeding hearts and all of that. There are deeper motives and there are deeper agendas, which we can't be so naive as to say that the world doesn't care about all of this. So who's driving it? What's behind it? That's for the intelligence agencies to look at. And that's perhaps why the government reacts in some cases. It doesn't react in some cases. But to deny and say it's just an spontaneous outburst is a bit much.
You want to make it about the government, right? I wanted to also bring in some innocent cases, like Evan Spiegel's case when he said India is too poor for Snapchat. India went crazy. There was a case of Maria Sharapova not recognizing Sachin Tendulkar, and that became a huge outrage as well. So there are some innocent cases also there. But we are running out of time. So
as Shashank said, I mean, if they have a right to say something, someone else in a non-violent way, if I troll him back, what's wrong with that? That's equal par for the course. You make a silly statement and we are 1.3 billion people. So all of us troll you back. So that's perfectly fine, right? What's wrong? We have the power of numbers on our side. So we'll keep trolling you.
I think everyone pretty much, other than Sanjay, everyone on the panel seems to agree with like there is bias and we have to react back. So
we won. Interesting, despite being less in number.
I need to share the poll results. 67% of the people in the attendees think that there is a Western bias against India. 60% people think that India does overreact to foreign criticism. And 87% people think that we should not ignore this criticism. Going back to sort of what Shashank is also saying. So that's quite impressive. I did not expect that. We have to wrap up. We're running out of time. So I'll give each of you 1 minute to sort of summarize your case. But please don't take longer than 1 minute. We really need to wrap it up. Shweta, please go ahead. We'll start with you.
Right. I think just taking away from Sampath's historical wisdom, I do think that there is a bias. There is a foreign press, a foreign media, a Hollywood, and that loves stories of poverty, of hunger, of distress. And taking away from my own experience of how media like to operate, negative narrative gets you more audience, full stop. You know, it gets you more audience, and that's what you need at the end of the day. You need more TR. And you need an audience to be hooked onto a story which may not be very positive, which may not glorify a certain country. And those are the kind of stories that also get you a lot of funding. But criticism does not make us weaker. It does not hit at our unity. And not every criticism is propaganda. We need not believe in every propaganda theory that's out there. Development, true development, is only possible if you recognize what's wrong. You know, if you can't change what's wrong, if you can't recognize what's wrong, you can't change what's wrong. So it's important to recognize when the criticism is constructive. We cannot brush it all aside saying that there is a foreign hand, a foreign agenda. At the same time, it's important to know that every story that is in the news, that is making the headline, may not necessarily be true. As India expands its global footprint, there is bound to be more scrutiny. And we may not want to answer every scrutiny with a public statement by the government of India, because that, remember, gets you more international audience. That gets more people talking the moment Indian government acts and reacts. So we may want to take it in good light, may want to react on certain things, may not want to get into every time a social media user puts out a negative comment of India. We may not want to react on every such comment, every such celebrity pop star tweet. And right. I think that's where we draw the boundaries.
Thank you, Shweta. We move on to Sanjay.
Well, Yajur, repeating for the last time, India at the moment is a flawed democracy. We are what I would call is a democratically elected autocracy. The biggest fallacy of our modern times is that people who are on the right side of the government, they believe everything is hunky-dory. And that's exactly what you're seeing on the panel. And I do believe that, ask those people the questions, the journalists, ask the corporates, ask the NGOs, ask the intellectuals and the authors who are harassed day in and day out. Ask those who are imposing self-censorship, what does it mean? And, you know, at the moment to dismiss all these, why are the democracy rankings plummeting down anyway? Where are we? I mean, this is the question that we need to ask ourselves. And one of the reasons why the Western world is asking you questions is because you go to them for money. You go to them to say, you know, give us FDI. Well, they have a right to question you on certain human rights issues. You cannot ignore that. I mean, today there are 70 million people. When Kashmir went into a quarantine, the world asked questions because they were worried about what it meant to have no internet in today's times. By the way, that is considered to be a violation of your freedom, rights. Yeah. So I think, at the end of the day, let's be honest, if you're insecure, if you're fearful, you'll find a reason to blame somebody. But I feel appalled and almost ashamed. Let me use strong words. You know, Shweta kept talking about this, I'm a politically neutral, of course. Nothing wrong. I myself have questioned my party, Shweta. Don't worry about that. Every political party is guilty, yes, of having tried to murder dissent. But what is happening today is at another scale. Okay, maybe you don't feel it, but many of your colleagues do, and I know them pretty well. And I need to put this on record, Yajur. That today has India become such a frightened nation? You know, after all the muscular speeches, are we so scared that a Rihanna, that a Washington Post or a CNN article that questions you legitimately because your house is not in order? If today India was truly a vibrant democracy, nobody would question you. But if Atish Tasi writes an article against the government of Mr. Modi, and you decide to now not give him his rights as an overseas citizen, the world is going to talk, just like we do on Trump, just like we do on Erdogan, just like we do on Putin, just like we do on Roger Duterte. I mean, this is the world we live in. There is a social media. We all are part of it. It's going to happen. So I think let's not be so thin-skinned. And most important, let's mature up as a democracy. We are still a work in progress.
Thank you, Sanjay. Let's not be so thin-skinned. Well said. We'll move on to Suprit, but before that, I want to encourage all of you to answer. There are some questions for you, Sanjay, for Shweta, for Suprit in the Q&A thing. You'll see a Q&A button and you can answer some of the audience questions directly. But let's move on to you, Suprit, please.
Thanks. To the question of whether there is a bias that exists, yes, there could be a bias that exists. There may be a bias that exists. Is it an international conspiracy? Probably not, right? Why are we only talking about Western bias towards us? Are we not people who are biased with people outside our own country, with our own people? Yes, we are. Human beings in general are like that. That's the human condition, right? The question isn't whether there is a bias. The question is how we deal with it and why does that bias exist, right? So that is what we need to look within ourselves and find a way to answer, right? For every Wendy Doniger example, you'll have 10 other people who would have written something factually correct also, right? If you are saying that she was factually incorrect, there would be 10 people outside this country who would have written things that are factually correct also. So yes, we have to look at the larger picture. We have to appreciate the fact that as a country, we are finding our own identity, right? For the longest time, we were fairly lost in terms of this united identity. And to mention what I think even Rabindranath Tagore has mentioned, the problem of India is her race. We are a multi-ethnic and we are a population. We are multiple countries in one country. So to get everybody together is always going to be a challenge that we're going to face. But to get everybody together based on fear, to get everybody together based on an us versus them sort of situation, I don't think is the right way to move forward. And therefore, to be thin-skinned and react every time is not something that is the correct way in my view. I think we need to be more accepting, we need to be more patient, and we need to understand and appreciate where we've come up till now. And yes, we live in a connected world. We can talk about them, they can talk about us. It shouldn't affect us that much all the time.
Thank you, Sukrit. We need to grow up and mature. Thank you summarizing that. And moving on to the again side now, Vikram, why don't you go first?
So I get back to what I said earlier. So to assume that everything is, a very spontaneous, innocent, there could be a lot of that also in the kind of reactions that come to different things around India. But then a lot of it is also agenda driven. And just as we say, have everyone sat in one room and decided that we'll have a bias against India. Similarly, I think the counter also, everybody is not going to be sitting somewhere and saying, let's push back and do this. That's to assume that everyone is acting in such a cohort manner. So I think social media that has given the power to every individual has made it possible. And I would reiterate what Shashank said in the beginning. So if Greta has a right to criticize us, rightly or wrongly, 1.3 billion Indians have a right to criticize her back. And so what is par for the course for her should be par for the course for us. If you do that, you can't be called as thin-skinned. So I think for the longest time, the narrative of India and for Indians, whether it is in terms of our politics, whether it's in terms of our, more importantly for me, matters of culture, history, and all of that, where the narrative is always, talked down to us in a very condescending manner by somebody sitting outside who's going to tell us that we know better about you and we will educate you about yourselves. It's, I think, time that slowly there is a pushback. And remember, when that pushback happens, it's not always going to be sophisticated. You can't compare the sophistry of someone who's been doing that for centuries with someone who's just learning the tricks of the trade. So there are going to be all kinds of loonies. There are going to be all kinds of crazy people. And in that churn is when I think the eventual wisdom will arise. And I certainly do not share the alarm on us being an elected autocracy or whatever. It's the same autocracy which puts that particular party in power in some states also. So I don't know what that is all about. So I think if if we don't have a good leader or a good program or a good vision for the country, which leads to us being elected, that doesn't mean that the country itself has failed. That's stretching it a bit too much. And and the same, you know, we've had all these 66A, we've had sedition laws against the Kudankulam protesters, we've had all of this. If Munawar Farooqi was arrested today, you had Asim Tripathi, who was also sent to jail, somebody who on sedition. You had Karthi Chidambaram, someone said something against him and he was packed off to jail. So every government has done this. And I wonder why, including our founding fathers of the constitution, Ambedkar and Nehru and others, allowed the sedition law, which was a colonial law, to be in the statute books. So there must have been some wisdom in why they did that. And it becomes a convenient tool for governments of all parties, all hues, state, center government, to use that against people. And so it can't be selectively criticized that one particular hue actually does it more than the other.
Going back to the main topic, wise words of an Indian historian, we need to regain control of the narrative about India globally. Thank you, Vikram. And Shashank, finally yourself, please go ahead.
Yeah, I would just like to summarize whatever I said. There is a missing causal link. I don't see any reason why we should become oversensitive. In fact, we should become less sensitive because we are gaining our self-esteem related to economy, related to many other things. And it shouldn't be very hard to accept that. There is no statistical link telling that we are actually much more, let's say, sensitive than the other countries in the similar domain. Of course, we cannot compare it with US or Germany. We should be comparing it with the countries that are in the same context. Basically, I don't see any link, basically factual link there. And what is actually happening, in my opinion, is that we are becoming more responsive, not more sensitive. And these are two different things. So if somebody is saying something and we are responding it back, it's a lively system. It's actually a good thing. You should be responding back, you're not deaf. And you should be actually analyzing, you should be doing more analysis and maybe responding more. This responding more is happening because of the social media, because of the page rank thing that I said earlier. And there I see a causal link. It also happens when you have more self-esteem, you have more confidence. I would like to finish with last sentence. Actually, when I was a kid, I saw Bill Clinton, who was not even a president, visiting India, and I see our parliamentarians pushing each other to shake hands with him. That image actually has changed a lot now when Trump visited even as a president, and people were not, you know, falling over themselves to actually shake hands with Trump. So we have gained self-esteem, we have gained, which is logical actually, and that's why we have become more responsive, not more sensitive. And it's a good thing, basically. And we should be discussing even more about these things with Wendy and with Greta and other people with more confidence.
Have you considered an alternative explanation for that?
No, Yajur, just a point to what Shashank mentioned. I thought Donald Trump was a stadium was created for him with 100,000 people. Yeah, I mean, you talk of talk of booing a president. That was it. Anyway.
But certainly, Sanjay, you would agree that we have gained confidence and we are not falling over Americans as much as we used to. At least this is my opinion.
I think there is a difference, right? So you're talking from a view of like an urban Indian living in the West, very mobile. And yes, I agree with you. I'm having lived in the US, I think Indian Americans are more confident than they ever were. Before they were embarrassed of their roots, they were trying to assimilate, and now they're proud and confident. But Sanjay is also thinking of the vast majority of Indians who are underprivileged still and who have. But we can't continue this debate anymore. There's a lot of interesting changes that have come up and we can have follow-on debates, of course. I'd like to thank all the panelists for your time. This was very insightful for me and hopefully also for all the attendees. Thank you all for joining. There will be a brief survey after the debate. So if you can just take out 2 minutes, and this is for the attendees, if you can take out 2 minutes to answer that, then we'll know what kind of topics you'd be interested in for future debates. And in case you want to watch previous debate videos, then you can find them on YouTube. In case you want updates, you can follow us on Instagram, YouTube, Twitter, or Facebook, wherever. So thanks a lot. Hope to see you again in future debates.
Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Great panel. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you.